gas, the little window hole, all these little sounds of the gate. She won't get the other, yet the lucky is in the last time I tell you, he's with the thumbs as I believe. She won't allow the sort of old things of the tongue of kings and the little lady about the day and the year of the road into the last place. He has seen the humble of the gate. Ara has seen the humble of the gate, and another has seen the humble of the gate. So the most of the day, I want to hide. Friends, it gives me very great pleasure and pride to participate in this function and speak in the presence of such devotees as are seated before me now. It is not that I know much, but that I enjoy whatever little I know. And I believe it is only the ability to enjoy the beauty and the glory of God that is the essence of Vishishta Advaita. In a book which I wrote some time ago, I wrote a few sentences about Vishishta Advaita. Vishishta Advaita is a system of integrated beauty and eternal joy. It is logically convincing, psychologically satisfying, emotionally rewarding, and epistemologically beatifying. It is the beauty of the forms of the Lord and His consorts, beauty of the archas, beauties of the Divya Deyasas. Beauty of the exegesis, beauty of the verses in the praise, beauty of the sensuousness of exposition, beauty of the language of discourse, beauty of the synthesis of Tamil and Sanskrit, and ever so many of the system that impresses one by its measureless appeal. It is this love of beauty and the experience of joy that made me go back to it again and again and again. In the life of Ramanuja, there are 100 instances which reveal to us how he is the appropriate person for being called the Acharya of the Millennium and also Bhagavat Ramanuja, a title that is not easily given to anyone, because the word Bhaga means that there are 6 qualities: Jnana, Bala, Aishwarya, Virya, Sakti, Tejas. A person who has all these things is called Bhagavan. And so to say Bhagavat is one who enjoys, one who is a recipient of, one who is basking in the smile of the Lord who possesses all these 6 qualities. That is why Ramanuja, as a very special person, has got a significant message to give to every one of us. Today, the world is torn, as it were, by so many isms, by contentions, by denials, by accusations, by extremisms, by so many other things. It was described in one of the poems that the center cannot hold, things fall apart, the people are full of passionate intensity, everybody strives but knows not for what he strives. We have become casual believers in passing creeds. With all these things, if you want to have an anchor which will be able to give you the, supply you, give you, provide you with something that is firm, to which you hold on, it is the feet of the Acharya. Ramanuja's divine feet, they give every one of us the hope. Ramanuja, I would say, is even greater than God. In one of the discourses, I made an observation. Ramanuja is greater than even Sri Rama. That is what I said. The point that I wanted to make is this. Before creation, men were all as jivas, doing nothing, losing themselves only in nothingness. They did not know their identity. It was only when the Acharya came and told them, well, you are this or you are that, they began to know what it is. Said, not being conscious of anything is not your status. You are consciousness personified. You are the agent. You are the doer. You have got all these rights. You must know all this. And therefore, he was able to give us an identity. And then gave us this. Remember that there are 3 qualities which you have to remember. One is Ananya Saranatvam, Ananyarha Seshatvam, Ananyarha Bhogyatvam. These 3 qualities, they define you. You are not you, because you are always part and parcel of that Lord to whom you are always a servant, the Kinkara. You are a servant. You are a servant. Well, you may even say a slave. The word slave in English has got political and racial associations. Therefore, when you use the word slave, people begin to wonder, what is this? How can that be slavery? It is not slavery. Perhaps it would be better to use the word servitude, because servitude is willing service. Virumbi yetrukonda adimaitanam. That's what we say. Willingness. Can there be willingness to be a slave? Yes. When the person you serve, he is not like any one of us, but one who is far, far beyond, transcendental, perfect in everything. Bhagavan, who has Jnanabala, Aishwarya, Virya, Sakti, Tejas. So now you are able to see how the Acharya is a kind of a balance, as it were, a bridge, as it were, a link, as it were, a connection, as it were, to connect the wandering Jivatma through mercy, through sacrifice, through surrender to that Paramatma. And the person, I would say, the engineer who was able to bridge that bridge was Sri Ramanuja. We were all, as I told you earlier, we were all just jivas, not knowing what we are doing, what we should do. He came and told us. So, those who are lying like logs of wood or like pieces of stone or rock, not knowing what they are, they were given a knowledge of their identity. That's the first thing. And then, this is not everything, because through this awareness, through this consciousness, you must be able to go to a place where all these things will consummate into eternal joy, limitless joy, yet permanent joy. That's why he becomes a person who gave you that. Nothing more. Now, you have many other ways. Bhagavad Gita speaks of Karma Yoga, so difficult to practice. Jnana Yoga, which will lead you only into I don't know what. It may even end up as Atmanubhava. Atmanubhava is not everything. And if you are going to say that I want Atmanubhava, you are actually discrediting the mercy which God uses in order to enjoy the beauty of His form, the beauty of His words, the joy of His very presence. Therefore, we have to go beyond all this. Well, then we should go to Bhakti. When it comes to Bhakti, it is so difficult to practice. Though we say, we are Bhaktas, how are we Bhaktas? What is Bhakti? It is infinite attachment to the Lord. You may say it is a kind of an intellectual awareness of the love that we have for God. Bhakti Rupa Apanna Jnana, they say. Amor intellectualis Dei, as Spinoza put it. Amor, it is love. Intellectualis brain. Dei is God. So it is an intellectual love of God. It is not enough if you say that I enjoy. You must be able to give me the grounds of your enjoyment. If you simply say, I enjoy, it is such, it is such, it is such, that is not going to make me either enjoy or experience. Therefore, you have to give the grounds. Ramanuja gave us the grounds for our enjoyment. That one prose poem that we have, the Saranagati Gadya, that itself is enough for us to know, to appreciate, to enjoy, to enter into the beatitude of that experience of God. So Ramanuja's great contribution is that he was able to make every one of us, that which has a stone, was made into a jiva. A jiva who knows his identity, who knows the way, who knows the goal. Then he made us understand that the ultimate goal for the Jivatma is his merging, no. Dissolving himself, no. Knowing, no. Is experiencing. You speak about Salokya, Samukya, Sarupya, Sayujya and all that. What is, when you say Sayujya, people are likely to mistake it to be Jiva Brahma Aikya. It is not. It is only Jiva Brahma Samya. We become equal in all ways, equal in enjoyment. But for a few things which you don't have, which only God can have, like Jayatkanartham, Lakshmi Vallabhartham, or Kausavadharartham, or Antarayamitvam. But for these things, all the other enjoyments are the same for the Jiva who becomes a Mukta. So Ramanuja said that this association between the Jiva and the Paramatma, well, how to explain? How to explain? Well, there's a beautiful metaphor. The metaphor which is able to bring out the association between the Jiva and the Paramatma in a way in which no other metaphor will ever be able to say. Because they speak of the sea and the wave, or the water and the ice, or the sun and the rays of the sun. Well, beyond all these things, when you want to come into the transactional relationship, all those things may be transcendental, they may be philosophical. But what we have today before us is a transactional relationship. What is it? It is between the husband and the wife. Well, the terms we have got to use, because there is no other way of doing it. It is not the physical relationship that we speak of. It is a spiritual relationship. And prapati is only atma vivaha. It is the marriage between the jiva and the paramatma. The jiva. Sir, I am a male jiva. My wife is a female jiva. How can we be married? Look here. The jiva does not have any sex or any gender. It is only when it is associated with the body, it becomes masculine or feminine. Masculinism or femininity is only an attribute. It does not in any way change the thing as it is in itself. Therefore, in the ultimate analysis, the jiva, in its association to God, becomes the wife of God. Well, in that relationship, when it becomes husband-wife relationship, it is not for procreation, but it is for attaining certain divine goals, enjoying the company of each other, each luxuriating in the company of the other. As you say, it is not that we want God, God also wants us. Between the two, there is a certain mutual relationship. Without me, he is not there. Without him, I am not there. But he is not me, I am not he. That kind of a peculiar balance Ramanuja brought into the awareness of the Visishta Advaita Gurudeva. When you speak of it as a philosophy, it is one thing. When you speak of it as a religion, it is a different thing. Philosophy is based on logic, is based on pramanas, whereas religion is based upon experience. Logic can establish anything. Even Shankara says that no amount of logic can make me believe that fire is cold, though it is possible to prove that fire is cold through logic. So when logic is something which can be negated by experience, experience holds the same. Experience is everything. Experience has to be communicated. That communication cannot be done by simply saying, well, I am enjoying, you also enjoy. I am so happy, you also be happy. When I say this, nobody will be. I love to give him the grounds for the enjoyment. Ramanuja gave them that enjoyment. That cause for enjoyment. I am happy because, even in the Saranagati, he speaks about it. One whole passage, the sentences are very long, but one whole passage is there where he describes the appearance of God, the haras, the garments, the ornaments that he wears. Everything is there detailed and how beautiful the whole thing is. So, it is that awareness of that beauty that makes us go back to, again, in fact I was reading in one of the books where he said, how is it that mysticism is so important in the Hindu religion, much more in Visishta Advaita than in any other religion? Because he says, mysticism is only yogic integration. It is becoming one with, or associated with, closely united with. See, all these words are very insufficient words. You have to use only that Sanskrit word, you cannot have any other word which can bring you anywhere closer to it. So, it is that peculiar relationship which the jiva has with the Paramatma that Ramanuja underlines. So, you and I, are you divine? Yes. If you are divine, how are you different from him? We are not different from him, we are only different aspects of him. I will put it this way. Another important metaphor that we have in Visishta Advaita discourse is that of the body and the soul. They call it the body-soul analogy. Sarira-sariri-bhava. Body-soul analogy. What is this? What is that body? Body is something which you have to negate. Body is something which is impermanent. Body which is the cause of, which is the result of some suffering that you have had, of your karma. And then how do you bring in all this? Well, it is a metaphor, remember. A metaphor is something which is able to communicate when you interpret it only in terms of the tradition to which it belongs. You must very clearly understand that. Even in literature we say, when you have a metaphor, the metaphor functions only within that particular cultural group or within that linguistic group. If you have to go beyond that, you will have to state that you are going beyond. I can illustrate it with a simple example, which should not be out of place here. In Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, there is a beautiful passage. When Romeo meets Juliet, he promises to her his love. He says, I will love you so long as the sun and moon shall endure. Sun and moon, in theology, are taken to be representatives of eternity. So, I will love you so long as the sun and moon are there. Surya Chandra Ullavare, we say. She retards. Swear not by the moon, the unconstant moon. who doth nightly change in the rock. Don't promise by that which is constantly changing. Today he is full moon. 10 days later he will be new moon. There will be no nothing at all. Does it mean that your love can be compared to that? No. It is not the way to approach the metaphor. The metaphor is to be interpreted only in terms of the conditions in which it is applied to that cultural or the linguistic group. So we shall take this sarira sariri bhava. Sarira is the body. The body has got the soul within it. Without the soul, the body has nothing at all. You may have all the external organs, mental paraphernalia. At midnight hour, the mind cannot support bodily or mental furniture, they say. They call all these senses as furniture, which only equip you. You have got the eyes. What is the furniture for unless somebody sits upon it? What is the eye for except when there is somebody to see through that eye? The eyes may be open, the man may be dead. Very often our ears are open, we don't hear what the others say. We say, you will have to register. Where do you register? What gives you that consciousness or awareness to register? It is that Paramatma who is there within you. Without him, nothing can happen. No, sir. I think. I act. Cogito ergo sum. I think, therefore I am. I think, therefore I act. You think. But thinking does not become action, except when the thought goes into the will and will gives the command for you to act. So, without the energy which is there inside, the will cannot function, reason cannot function. Without will or reason, the bodily movement cannot be. Therefore, the body is totally dependent upon what is there inside you. It is God's will which acts through you. So, the body and the soul are connected in such a way that they are inseparable. When the soul is away, the body is nothing. It is decaying matter. It is carcass. So, Ramanuja gave us this sarira sariri bhava. Sir, that is very difficult, sir. I cannot understand. The sarira sariri. But people say that everything belongs to the world of the panchabhutas. And there is a growth, there is a decline. The body disappears, the body goes away. Then how can you make the soul the resident of this panchabhautika sarira? The answer is not far to see. Because the Upanishads again and again proclaim that this prithivi is his sarira, the jiva is his sarira. Everything that you see here is only part of his body, it is only his constitution that makes all the world work, all the creation work. So, sarira sariri, just as the body is totally dependent upon the soul for its actions, for its awarenesses, for whatever it does, the jiva is totally dependent upon God. Who is there inside you? So, it is a kind of a concentric circle, you may say. The world around, the body, the jivatma, and then the paramatma. So, the paramatma moves everything. The viewing of, the understanding of, the phenomenology of the spatio-temporal world is only because of the awareness that is there within you, and that is there because of the atma that is there within you. Don't say that all this is illusion. Illusion? Well, to define illusion is difficult. Unless there is a person to see the illusion, where is the illusion? Unless there is a ground for the existence of that illusion, where is the illusion? Immediately they will say, well, we are able to see the illusion of the mirage. The mirage is an illusion. Yes, it is an illusion, but not for Ramananda. Because it is not that it is not there, or else you will not see. Only thing is, there must be some little water. Without water, there is no illusion. If there is an illusion of water, there may be some element of water in it which may not be useful for us. Merely because it is not useful for us, you cannot say it is not there in it. Mirage is a very convenient example. You go to the point where you find the mirage, you go there, there is no mirage at all. Was it not an illusion? But when you saw it, was it an illusion? Did you not think it was water? So, by the principle of quintuplication or panchikarana, he is able to establish that all these things that we say before, in spite of all that change, the growth or the decay or the repairs or the recreation, all these things have got a certain permanence within them, a certain part of the permanence. It is of that that the body belongs. All of us belong to his body. You may say, if I belong to the body, I am a sinner, how can I belong to the holy body of God? Well, there is a beautiful way in which our Siddhanta explains the whole thing. See, when there is a body and the body has got organs, am I the hand? No, I am not. Am I the leg? No, I am not. That is right. But if I am not the leg, what am I? Can I be without the leg? Can I be without this or without that? When you ask such questions, you will understand that the body is a part of, the hand is a part of the body, but the body is not hand. The body does exhaust hand, but the hand does not exhaust God, the body. Similarly, the jiva can explain the Lord, but the Lord cannot be negated merely by the existence of the jiva. That is what he called the sarira sariri bhava. Ramanuja again and again and again establishes this basic principle. I would consider that just two metaphors will be enough for this Advaita. One is the bridal mystical relationship between the jivatma and the paramatma. What you call the nayaki nayaki bhava, or what you call the madhurya bhava. The other one is this particular aspect of the body soul relationship. These two are metaphors to be taken as metaphors. And then the metaphor will be able to give you all the ideas that are there concealed in them. That is what Ramanuja was able to tell us. When you read the life, how glorious the life is. I was recently writing a book, expanding or commenting on the 108 names with which Ramanuja is worshipped in the temples. Ramanuja Ashtotra Satam. There are certain, this actually happened as a beautiful experience to me when I was there at Malakote. The Archana was performed for Ramanuja. All of you know, there are three kinds of bodies. The Tanurunda Trimeni, Tamarunda Trimeni, Taniyana Trimeni. He is called the Tamarunda Trimeni. As the priest was there, offering the flowers, uttering the name, each one very clearly, Spashtama. I began to wonder, do we not find the entire history of Ramanuja, the life of Ramanuja, the philosophy of Ramanuja, the incense connected with this life, don't we see all of them encapsulated, as it were, in the 108 names that have been given? Then I thought, it must be that I will one day write a commentary on the 108 names, bringing out the significance of each one of them. And among them, there are two names which I personally love so much. There are so many other things. Not that I did not love. He is called Anaga, he is called Granagala, he is called Pushkaraksha, he is called by all other names. But I said two of them attract me very much. One is Gopika Moksha Pradayakaya Namaha. Another is describing him as the father-in-law of Srinivasa. He is the father-in-law of Srinivasa. Lord Srinivasa of the Seven Hills. I was lured by both these things. I just could not understand. How can you say that Ramanuja is a father-in-law? I have heard people say that Ramanuja is the Acharya of Tirumalai Venkatachalapati because he gave him the discus in the conch. Well, how is he the father-in-law? In a discourse I heard, Ramanuja offered to Srinivasa of Tirupati Hills a small golden idol or dollar or locket, whatever you may call it, of Mahalakshmi, which is there all the time around his neck. Vakshastala Mahalakshmi, Hridaya Mahalakshmi, Swarna Mahalakshmi. You speak about the Sri Devi and the Bhudevi, yes, but beyond all that, there is this Vakshastala Mahalakshmi. So Ramanuja, by giving him Vakshastala Mahalakshmi, by giving his daughter as it were in marriage to him, becomes his father-in-law. He is the father-in-law, of course, in many ways. Ananta Advani is sometimes called the father-in-law because he gave him flower garlands. Akasa Raja, mythologically, is his father-in-law, all of us know. But Ramanuja is called the father-in-law. See, Lord Venkatesa has got all the luck. Yes. Ramanuja as his father-in-law, he has Ramanuja as his Acharya. What more do you want? That is the greatness of our Acharya. One who could be the father-in-law and also the Acharya of he who is the Lord of the Seven Hills, who who has come down to redeem all of us from our days of servitude, from our days of ignorance and sin. The other one, Gopika Moksha Pradayakaya Namaha. This name actually confused me for a while. I just could not think. Gopika Moksha Pradayakaya, one who conferred moksha upon the Gopikas. That seems to be the very plain meaning. Well, he didn't do it. In fact, he belonged to a century much later than that of the Gopikas. Then what does he mean by that? There is some other meaning in it. I just could not comprehend. I kept away the book. I just meditated, perhaps for a week, for 10 days, thinking of it all the time, looking at the picture of Ramanuja that I have in my heart, of course, and of course in the Sanghadi that we have in our house. And today it flashed upon me. Why not you consider it this way? You know, there are two samasas which are very important in Sanskrit. Tatpurusha samasa, Bahuvrihi samasa. Why should you take it only in one case, take it in the other case? Oh, now it began to be very clear to me. One who is able to give to us the kind of moksha which Gopikas got. What is that Gopika moksha? How is it different from our moksha? Gopika moksha is easy moksha. Did they ever take a bath?
No.
Offer oblations?
No.
Did Sandhyavanam? As they say, though they belong to a caste where if they wash the head, they won't wash the body, when they wash the body, they won't wash the head. And they will do this alternately once in 6 months, they say. And they are stinking with, that's what we would say in these days of body spray. They are stinking with the smell of stale butter. Well, how is it that they got? They did not have Swarupa Jnanam. Go and ask them, what is Anandarya Seshatvam? Anandarya Bhogyatvam? What do you know about them? They know nothing. We know only Krishna, we know nothing else. So, Yatrikam, Yayayam Pravikam, say, they don't want to say, now I will leave this world and go with you. No. Yatrikam, Yayayam Pravikam, Mundan Nod Utromiyavam. Lord Krishna, you are here before us in form, as Archa, as the incarnation. Though I don't like the word incarnation, I will come to it presently. We have fallen in love with this form that you have presented to us. And we will be in love with it. Not only now, it's like it. Yatraiko, Yerel Varevikam, Undanor Utramiyavam, Umake and Archayavam. So, we are not like those people who said, I will go there, see if he is like Ranganatha. If he is not like Ranganatha, I will come back. No such thing for the gopis. I don't know Ranganatha. I don't know Mahavishnu. I don't know God sitting upon the Sarsasarpa with Sridevi, Bhudevi, Neela Devi, Napini Pirati, adored by all the Mukta Jivas and served by the Nitya Muktas. We do not know any of those things. You are here, we are here, we want to have only this, nothing else. That's why they say, Etrekkum, Yeryayam Viravikkum, Undannod Uttrayamiyavum, Umakkena Maatrayavum. In fact, on one occasion when I was speaking at our temple, we have got two inscriptions there. One is, Vadivil Kalamallam Udanai Mani Vadivila Adivi Sayavayanam. Good. That is the Parama Purushattam. On the other side, we have this line. Kandan Kainale Nannu Madamudiye Ennum Thirunamam Thirunam Naranamay. Which is the goal, which is the path? You will decide for yourself. Kandan Kainale Nannu Madamudiye. What is your goal? The feet of Lord Krishna. How can you reach it? Kandan Kainale Nannu Madamudiye Chinnam, Thindu, what they need is the name of Narayana. Narayana is only the path. Krishna is the goal. That goal is there before us. Ennum Thirunamam, Thinnam Narayana. Certainly it is only this name which will take you to Kandan Kailinai. So why should we go there and find out? After all, you are here, your feet are there before us. We are in everyday samsration with you. There is no visitation, we don't want it at all. Therefore we are here. That kind of a release, that kind of a mukti, that kind of a paradise, that kind of a paramapadam, whatever you may call it, that is what we want. Etrikum, Yerel Varevikum, Mundanor Utromiyavum, Ubake Namatevum, Matre Namam Kamangal Matre, even if it is the Kama for paramapadam, even that change. Matre Nam Kamangal, but for this, no, how about that? It is not just Vishaya Kama from which we want to take our mind. We want to take our mind away from even the Kama of our Paramaguru. Ramanuja gave us that. That's why he says, Gopika Moksha Pradayakaya. So can there be an easier way to heaven than this? There is no fourth door here. He takes us along the path. He goes along with us. In fact, he shows us the path, waits there to see whether we go along the path, not minding that he is not himself going along the path. That's what you say when he went to the Trikotir Swami and asked him, and he imparted him the secret message. What did you do? You shall not give it to people who do not deserve it. It is a secret mantra. You should come only with your Pavitra in London, and he came, all of you know all the story. I shall not go into that. He came and announced it to all people. It is not that he climbed up on the tower and then spoke at all that. He spoke to people, even if you cast the pearls before swine, they wouldn't know what it is. Therefore, what Ramanuja did was, a purpose of prodigious love. All those who can take. A person who does not know the value of a diamond will throw it away. It is of no use to him. Whereas a person who knows the value, he will take it up. In a similar way, the name of God, that mantra, was given by Ramanuja to everyone, all of you. It is not for the fixed one. It is not for the chosen one. It is not for this. It is not for that. It is for everybody. All of us can reach. That is a great change. As a one statement I have made in that book also. What he did was, Kulathalave Ahumam Gunam was changed into Gunathalave Ahumam Kulam. That is a fundamental reorientation of our appreciation of the goal of human life, of the goal of all the spiritual endeavors that we have. Such great Ramanuja. He is our Acharya. And it is said that, and it is said that just remembering the feet of Ramanuja is itself enough to take you to heaven. Because in Sampradaya they say, all those who are born before him are sanctified by contact with his head. And all those who are born after him, they are sanctified by the holiness of his feet. Therefore, anyone who has got any kind of contact with Ramanuja will be rid of all the sorrows of this existence and enjoy heaven here and now. That is, wherever you are, is heaven for you. Even in Rahasyatrasara, Vaisigan very clearly says that after your prapatti, what should you do? What did Ramanuja say? Whenever it is possible, offer service to the saints, the acharyas, the people who are devoted to God, and constantly contemplate upon the meaning of the Charma Sloka and repeat the Dvayam. As for the Ashtaksharam, it is esoteric, we shall not go into it now. So, when Lord Krishna said, Aham Tva Sarva Papyabhyo Mokshesham. See, Aham and Mam are the two things we are supposed to give up. But in the Charma Sloka he says, Aham, Mam, both of them are there. Saradharma and Paritajya, Mam. Mama is there. Aham is there. He can have. Because we too can have when it is Swati Ahankara. I am a devotee of. I am the chosen man of. I am the Prapanna. I am the servant of the Lord. That kind of an ego all of us can have. So in the life of Ramanuja, there are many, many incidents where he speaks about or he lived. I am often lured by one or two expressions in English. People say, I am an open book. Ramanuja is an open book. When you say open book, what is meant in English parlance is, there is no secret for me to hide. My life is an open book. I have no secrets. I have no skeletons in my cupboard. That's what it means. But I think that it must have a different meaning when we come to Ramanuja. Ramanuja's life is an open book because from the book you can read all the principles of Vedanta, all the principles of religion, all the principles of your pathway to God, all the principles of your realization. Do you want to know the Arthapanchaka? There it is. Do you want to know the Tattva, Hita and Purushartha? There it is. So, Ramanuja's life is an open book, not merely in the English idiomatic sense. It is open in a purely Visishtadvaitic, Vedantic sense. My professor often used to say, you know, there is a new kind of Vaishnavism that is coming up. It is called Oxford Vaishnavism. I asked him, what is that, sir? What is Oxford Vaishnavism? He said, it is a Vaishnavism which is based upon all the texts being rendered into English. They don't know a single word of Sanskrit. But all these things have been translated into Sanskrit, into English, and people, they quote only the chapter and words from the English translations. So that Vaishnavism is Oxford Vaishnavism because it is based upon the texts which are actually translated into the English language. That is the anatom I also have made, you see, this Rahasya-Trayasaram, which has been recently published. So, Ramanuja's life is an open book. Take it from the beginning to the end, wherever it is. Loyalty, allegiance, undivided attention. As they say, Taila-Dharavati, Avichinda, contemplation of God. That is difficult, therefore what should you do? Do the way in which the gopis did. That's why Ramanuja is often called Tirupavijaya. Because everywhere, a short while ago when Swami was speaking, he referred to it, Tirupavijaya. How Atvadai appeared to him as Napinai as she came out playing with the ball. And then the master inside said, Tirupavijaya Anusandhanamo, Pavinatambasa Anusandhanamo, they said. He is Tirupavijaya, not in this way, as a brother to Anda, he offered the 108 cups, I call them thala, of butter and akkaradisil. Akkaradisil is a very significant thing. It is not just akkarapongal or akkaradisil, because akkaram is jagal. Adisil is food, salam. Akkaradisil is only vella salam. But this akkaram is a very interesting term, because the Alvar, in his place of Yatikacharam, he says, Akkarakkani, he calls Narasimha, who is there upon the Yatikacharam. Akkarakkani, what is that? Kani, I understand. Akkarakkani, Vellapadam. How can there be a Vellapadam? Vellathiye, Lattu, and the Vellame, Vellachidiya vandhu, அதுலேயே ஒரு வெள்ளை பழம் பழுத்தா அந்த வெள்ளை பழம் எப்படி இருக்கும்? அப்படிப்பட்ட இனிப்பு. அக்காரக்கன் அக்காரம் இஸ் ஜாகரி ஸ்வீட். ஸோ தட் இஸ் வை ராமானுஜர் இஸ் ரெஃபர் டு ஆஸ் அண்ணா. தட் இஸ் வை இந்த வாழ்த்தினும் ஆல்சோ வி சே தட் பெரும்பூதூர் மாமனிக்கு பின்னாநாள் வாழியே ஹி லிவ் பெர்ஹாப்ஸ் இன் த 4th செஞ்சுரி ஆர் 7th செஞ்சுரி தெர் இஸ் அ டிஸ்பியூட் அபவுட் விஷன் கோயிண்டி லிவ் மெனி மெனி செஞ்சுரிஸ் பிஃபோர் ராமானுஜர். How can then he be the elder brother? Just as the elder brother fulfills the desires of the sister, he fulfills the desire of Anna, and therefore he is called Anna. So Ramanuja's life, in every incident that he does, in every action, so many, many things that we have to speak of. One particular thing I thought I should refer to. This happened when Kuratharva, after he lost his eyes, left Srirangam and went to Aragarpoya. There he was serving the Lord. There are some very interesting things there. How for that God alone, they accept Aralipu. In other temples they don't. Aralipu is not supposed to be offered to Vishnu. But in Aragarpoya, it is being offered. Because they say, when Kuratharva was there, because he was blind, he didn't know what flowers he was gathering. He gathered flowers, put the strandam into a garland, offered, and the Lord accepted it. Even today, they take Arali Mala as Malai when you go to. Well, in that place, one day, it was afternoon. Kuratharva was there sitting in a bench in a garden. Tears were streaming down his cheeks. There appeared a person, he was blind, he didn't know. Some person stood before him probably and said, "Why are you crying? It is no matter for you, I cry." "No, no, you tell me, I will bring solace for you." "You cannot bring solace. Nobody can bring me solace. Look here, do you know who is there standing before you?" "I know very well." "Okay. How do you know? You don't have eyes. From the smell of the garland which I spin for you every day, which you are now wearing, I know you are Aragar." "Well, do you think I cannot do it?" "You too cannot do it. What is it?" "I want to have the experience of the gopis. I want to be a gopi, gopika, and enjoy." "Well, I shall make you one gopi in your next birth." He said, "You cannot." "Why?" "You cannot give me another birth." "How?" "I am a follower of Ramanuja. Therefore, moksha is assured for me. You have said that from moksha nobody can come. So, even you cannot give me that." The God realized how the Acharya is more important than anything else, and Ramanuja's life illustrates nothing but that greatness. Did he ever seek anything for himself? Did he seek anything of what you may call the grandeurs of the earth? No. He wanted only the emancipation of every soul. I am not very happy with that word, but English words are such. I use the word emancipation. It has got a certain political connotation. I use the word incarnation. Incarnation. And even anthropomorphism. Those are words which I am not able to reconcile myself to, but they are the only words available there. Incarnation, etymologically, is incarnate. Carnal is flesh. Incarnate is to become flesh. Does God become flesh? That is made by the Panchabhutas? It is Suddha Sattva. It is eternal matter out of which the body is made. It does not grow, it does not decay, it does not sink, it does not prosper, it does not feel hunger, it does not feel sleep, anything at all. That is the nature. And when you say incarnate, well, I don't like that. I always say manifest. Instead of using the word incarnation, I always use the word manifest. He manifested himself. He is everywhere. Avyaktam vyaktam, we say. When there is vyakti and vyapti, vyapti shows itself in vyakti. That is how you are able to see. So, when he presents us the glorified form of his body, which you call Deva Tirumeni, we call it Tirumeni, we don't call it Sarira. Rumanik Sarira na Sarira. Sariram by itself is one that decays, but here it is Divya Tirumeni. So, Ramanuja made us involve ourselves in the beauty of the form, and the beauty of the form which he recommends unto us was given to him by the Alvars, more especially Tirumangiyaru. Tirumangiyaru's contribution has been only to draw us again and again and again to that beautiful form of the Lord. In the form of the Lord, yes, in the Archamurti. There are so many, many other things, of which one thing is, he is called Rishikesa. Rishikesa is one who controls the senses. Well, does he control his senses? Is there any meaning for the term when you look at it that way? One who is able to control your senses. He draws your eyes, your ears, your smell of sense, of touch, of everything to him. So, he is Rishikesa. That Rishikesa, one who is able to control your senses because of his divine beauty, that is the beauty to which Ramanuja pointed his hand and said, "All of us, come on, enjoy that beauty. Can there be greater beauty than that? Or else, why should he be of the tradition which brought Alavanda to worship the beauty of the form of Ranganatha? One, the Pillayuranga Vidyadasa, who was brought to the beauty, or even Yamba, whom was able to win as it were. He was called Kaikonodanayana, all of you know. I shall not go into all those things. How he was able to bring him by merely chanting certain verses. Pum Pusaniyum Tahumo. And he said, "Takadi, Takadi," he said, "jump down, fall at the feet of Perinamihar." So, that is the greatness of Ramanuja. One who was able to make every stone. Rama made one stone into a woman. But Ramanuja made every stone into a woman and made every woman a bridegroom and made her marriage sure to that one Lord. And therefore, Prapati as the divine marriage, as the marriage of the spirit, as Atmavivaha, is the soul and the breath of the Vishishtadvaita that Ramanuja established. Thank you.